Mysterious Traveler.
This is the Mysterious Traveler, inviting you to join me on another journey into the realm of the strange and the terrifying. I hope you will enjoy the trip, that it will thrill you a little and chill you a little. So settle back and get a good grip on your nerves, if you can. Where are we going? Why, tonight we're going on a little excursion into the realm of pure imagination. You've all heard the old saying, believe in a thing enough and it'll come true. Well, suppose many people came to believe in something that couldn't possibly be real. Such as an artificial monster growing in a scientist's laboratory. What would happen? But if you want to know what might happen, listen to the story I call If You Believe. My story begins in a rambling old house deep in the woods. In a homemade laboratory, gray-haired Professor Jonathan Davis is peering eagerly into a large glass container that holds an odd, transparent, jelly-like substance.
Ellen! Oh, Ellen!
Yes, Dad?
Ellen, come quick.
I'm coming, dear. What is it?
Ellen, look. I think I've succeeded at last.
Oh, Dad.
You look. Your eyes are better than mine. Yes? Isn't there movement in the protoplasm this time? Isn't it stirring? Just a little?
No, Dad. There isn't any movement.
No? You're positive, Ellen? I was sure I saw some sign of life.
I'm quite positive, Dad. Now, please, won't you admit that what you're trying to do is impossible?
No, Ellen. No, I will succeed. I know it. Now, come, we've got to try another feeding mixture. You hand me the saline solution and the dextrose, and I'll begin again.
But while Professor Davis labored in his lonely seclusion to make a lifelong dream come true, something that was to affect him vitally was happening in the editorial room of the largest newspaper in the nearby city.
City desk, Benson speaking. Oh, hello, Mr. McGuire. Yes? Well, yes, sure, I've been reading Dan Duncan's special features. I edit them. I see. You don't think they've been colorful enough lately, huh? Well, to tell the truth, I agree with you. I've been meaning to speak to him about it. Yes. Sure, I'll do it now. He just came in. Right. Right. Good night, Mr. McGuire. Hey, Dan.
Yeah, Joe. What cooks?
The big boss just phoned down.
What's he want?
Well, frankly, he thinks you're slipping.
McGuire thinks I'm slipping. Well, I like that.
That's what he said.
And I've done everything to get hot material except to go out and commit a murder myself.
Well, maybe he's tired of murders. You want to know why you don't turn up something like that haunted house story you did last spring?
Why, I don't. That was a good story, wasn't it?
It was a honey.
Yeah. Especially the description of the way the ghost of the drowned girl walked around the house, leaving wet spots where it stepped. You know, I caught a heck of a cold walking around in wet socks to make those footmarks.
No more than you deserve for faking a story.
You're faking a story. Listen, Benson, any time a million readers believe a story, it's true. And they believed in that ghost. Every one of them.
I'm not saying they didn't, but McGuire wants another story just as good.
I got a good mind to tell the old buzzard to fly a kite. Another story like... Hey.
Huh? What is it?
I think I got it. Hey, Ted. Ted Jones.
Oh, yeah, Dan.
Front and center.
Oh. Yeah, what is it, Dan?
All right, dump your camera on the desk and sit.
Okay.
Now, tell me, what was that story you told me last week about some professor living up in the woods back at town, never coming out of his private lab?
Oh, you mean Professor Davis?
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah. Well, what about him?
There was a fuss over something he said in a lecture one day, wasn't it?
A fuss? Oh, it was more like an explosion.
Hey, wait a minute. I remember that case. The professor claimed he could create an artificial man, wasn't that it?
No. He said that an artificial man might be produced someday. Might be.
Well, the paper said he claimed he could create one.
Yeah, I know.
Well, it made a good story, didn't it?
And drove Professor Davis out of the university into retirement. Oh, the school didn't like the publicity.
Water under the bridge, kid. Anyway, here's the old professor working away secretly for the last 5 years. All alone?
No, he wasn't all alone. His daughter Ellen's with him.
How old is she?
Whoa. She was 15 then, so...
She's 20 now. Good looker?
Well, I was in Professor Davis's class. I remember as a... Well, it's a skinny brat with yellow hair.
Yeah, good, a blonde. So here's the prof secretly working with his beautiful blonde daughter at what?
I'll bite. What?
Why, he's trying to prove he was right. He's trying to create an artificial man.
Say, you've got something there.
Oh, now, wait a minute. You don't know Professor Davis is trying to create artificial life.
Well, we soon will. You know where his hideout is, don't you?
Yeah,
all right, then grab your camera. Let's get going.
Oh, no, wait a minute, Dan. Suppose you find Professor Davis is...
Ah, forget it. Benson, save me 2 columns. Come on, Ted. We're on our way.
There, Ellen. It's done. Now we must warm it ever so gently. It'll stay at blood heat until morning. And then, Ellen...
Oh, I hope so, Dad, but... Darling, if you fail again, won't you please promise me to stop trying to create this artificial protoplasm?
Well, we'll talk about that in the morning. Now, Oh, who could that be?
I'll go see, Dad. Yes?
I'm Ted Jones, Miss Davis. I don't suppose you remember me.
Ted Jones? Oh, you were one of Father's students, weren't you?
Yes, that's right. I'm a newspaper photographer now. Oh. Could we come in? I have a friend with me, a reporter.
Ellen, and... who is it?
Newspaper men, Dad. They want to see you.
Newspaper men, don't let them in. Send them away.
I come now, Professor. We just want to ask you a couple of questions, and but we can talk better inside, so... There. Now we can talk like friends.
Hey, but Dan, we weren't invited in.
How dare you force your way in here? Get out, both of you.
Please go.
Dan, come on. Professor Davis doesn't want to talk to us.
Keep your shirt on, Ted. Just a couple questions, Professor. Now, isn't it true that hidden away here, you're creating artificial life?
I won't answer your questions. You just print more lies and ruin everything I'm trying to do.
Then you are creating artificial life, huh?
Young man,
Tell me how far you've gotten. You figuring on springing an artificial man on us one of these days?
You fools. While I still struggle to create synthetic protoplasm, you talk of artificial men. Go before I throw you out.
Please go, please.
Come on, Dan, we're leaving.
Okay, we're going. Thanks for the interview, Professor. Read all about it in tomorrow's Courier.
The imbeciles. What do they know of science? All they want is to cheapen my work, make it a sensation for the headlines.
Now, please, Father, you must get control of yourself. They've gone now.
Yes, dear. They shan't interfere with my work. Well... Come, we must adjust the heat. Ellen.
Yes, Dad, what is it?
Ellen, the mixture's moving. This time I'm sure of it. The protoplasm, it's alive.
Say, Dan, this is something. Behind bolted doors deep in the woods... Professor Jonathan Davis toils night and day to create the world's first synthetic man. In a great vat lies a strange caricature of humanity. It has a head, arms, legs, a body, all of them fashioned of a pale green substance like gelatin.
Nice touch, huh?
Day by day, life stirs more strongly in this grotesque creation of science. Someday it may breathe, walk, eat... Now, look, Dan, aren't you going pretty strong?
Ah, forget it. The old man wants a story, doesn't he? Besides, the professor really is working on synthetic protoplasm. Maybe he has got a pale green monster in his bathtub. How do I know?
Okay, Dan, but if you're faking this story, I know nothing about it. Faking it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.